think that's where a lot of people go bad with a pup. They throw them in a pen and just throw feed to them every day. And to me, you got to make a connection with them. Some guys don't agree with me on that, but I think you got to have a good bond with a dog.
It's real simple, I think, with a pup, and a lot of people don't understand it. When a pup is ready to start, it will start. You can't force a pup to start, and you can't force a pup to tree. It has to do it on its own.
Hello and welcome to the Stark Outdoors Podcast. I'm your host, Clayton Stark. In today's episode, I sat down with the Dunlap family and I had a nice conversation with Don, Chuck, and Colton Dunlap. We talked about everything, competition hunting, family, starting pups, pleasure hunting. It was a really great time and I look forward to getting together with them in the future. And it was a really great conversation and I hope you guys enjoy it. All right, so I'm sitting here with Chuck. With Chuck. You want me to do Chuck first? You can both go together too if you want to, but we can start with Chuck. So you just want to introduce yourself, kind of tell us how you got into it.
My name is Chuck Dunlap. I started coon hunting back when I was probably 11 or 12 years old. I'm right around there, son. Trained my first dog when I was 11 or 12 years old. We, as a family, come up to Ohio from West Virginia, and how I got to liking a hound was my grandpa had an old black and tan that run around in the yard, and I'd just pretend like I was hunting it and go down in the backyard and fool around with it.
Yeah.
And he dug some holes in the yard, and my grandma made him get rid of it, and it really made me mad. And I was just like the hound ever since, you know.
Yeah.
So when I got out here, I was about in the fifth grade, and a fella took me up to Bertone's. Do you know who Bertone was?
That last name I recognize.
Yes, he was an English man. He had a world champion dog called Vincent Sam. And I got a pup out of his hotshot dog, and that's the very first dog that as a young boy, I trained. And I trained her to completion and went on from there. So that's probably been 48 years ago or so. And along that time, he started going with me, and you know, we just developed a bond and hunted, you know, and had a lot of, you know, had a lot of good brother time with each other. And we don't hunt together as much as we used to. But when we were young, we was almost inseparable when it come to coon hunting.
And that's something I noticed a few competition on, especially. Most times you don't hunt a lot together with people because you try and work on things with your dog to get it ready.
You bet.
So that is something.
Me and him could work good together, and me and him works real good together.
Yeah.
My son's my biggest hunting partner now.
Yeah.
I guess when I advanced a little bit, it would have probably been, I hunted with a dog called Loomis in a ACHA hunt up at Greenwich, and he really impressed me, and I wanted a pup out of him because I had English dogs at that time.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that was in 1980, and I started questioning everybody and, you know, I was really trying to get a pup out of him. Well, I ended up the guy that handled him had a back problem, and I started hunting him. Well, I took him, I think it was in 1980, and I took him for a couple years, and I went to the PCA Nationals then, but it was their equivalent of a world hunt.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I got him through and got to the final four with him. It was a final four that year, and ended up second place with him. And I started breeding dogs off of him, and I raised four or five generations deep off of that dog, had good success. And a friend of mine bred one of my females to Rooster, and Wyatt Wright really got interested, and he ended up buying all the females that I had and all the females he had, and then I needed to hunt for something else, because when you're a guy that trains your own dogs, you got to have something to train, and it's not real important if you've got plenty of money and you can buy the best that's out there. you don't have to worry about bloodlines. Well, I got without that bloodlines of English dogs. I found these Buck Creek dogs that I really, really, they was a type of the English dogs that I had. They were nice, and I liked them, and I started breeding them, and I've bred them for the last 20 years.
And most of all, both of them had coons, you know, when they treated.
Right. Both bloodlines. Yeah, it wasn't a question whether you was going to see a coon when you went there. If you didn't see one, you was upset. You went in there knowing that you had a coon.
And what he's saying about people that has money that can go out and buy a dog, that's great.
Not cutting them down.
Horses or anything, if they got enough money, they can buy it. But I'll tell you this from experience. If you win a world hunt, which I have with a dog that I didn't train, that I just kept in shape and hunted it and had it ready for that hunt, there's no comparison. There's no comparison to one that you've took from a weaned pup and raised it up from a puppy and developed it into a world champion. There's no comparison at all.
Mr. Smith started out over at my place, and I got him treeing coons, and he took him the rest of the way and won 2 world hunts. We held him when he was a little baby.
Yeah. You know? Yeah, that is pretty special, because then you are directly responsible and see every step of the way of what that dog is.
With talking about Mr. Smith, the dog that I got right now, you go back to Preacher, I hunted and handled him. He's won 3 world hunts, and Colton's won one and in the Nationals. I've had my chance. I got a 2nd and a 5th. That would have been in the UKC world hunt with a Buck Creek dog. I need to straighten that up a little bit. There's Preacher, Smith, Jackson, Johnny, and Croson. That's 5 generations of dogs that I've had something to do with, he's had something to do with, and my son has.
And we'll hunt them dogs until we can't hunt no more.
Yeah.
That'll be the line of dogs that does. Not that we wouldn't take another dog if we run into a good dog, and we could get it, we take it, but we're for sure with this bloodline, that's what we're going to continue to hunt, because we've had so many of them that just panned out and worked out, because they all like to have coons, and they're the type of dogs that we like to hunt.
And none of us like slow dogs. I like a dog when you unsnap it, it digs in there and goes hunting good, moves around good, and when it hits a track, it moves that track out and trees a coon. That's what I like. Yeah. And that's for young people that's thinking about getting into it, that's what they got to figure out first, what they like.
Yeah.
Then either you go buy it or you train it.
Yeah. And I always tell them, too, if you can hunt with the dog's parents, if you're getting a young dog, that way you can kind of see. And even if just doing it once, you might not know either, because it probably took you guys a while to see what preference you had to where you want to stick with that certain bloodline the way you do now.
Right.
It's a growth process for you as well.
You bet.
To figure it all out. And I try and get people to keep an open mind, because like you said, you started with English dogs, and now you got walkers. So if you weren't open-minded to where you wanted the best dog that you had that had coon, you probably didn't care if it was purple or green or what it was, as long as it was the best dog.
Talking about these Buck Creek dogs, if I could, people slam their mouth sometime and say, oh, they don't have no mouth. Well, there's some of them that don't. But most of them have a high piercing, carrion-type mouth that I love. Yeah. I can hear that, and I can pick it out better. When I was younger, I judged a lot of PCA hunts, PKC, PCA. I could pick out a dog after the first drop. I could figure them all out. Mm-hmm. Well, as I got older, I still hear good, but I can't pick out them ball mouth dogs and separate them like I could when I was 25 or 30 years old.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure Don's the same way about that. All right. Like something I can be walking and I know that's mine.
Yeah.
Don, you want to tell them a little bit about especially with Smith, with the world hunt?
The coon hunting's been real good to me ever since, like Chuck said, we was little, we hunted and stuff, and probably the biggest hunt that I won right off the bat was a hunt called the Futurity, and I won it with a blue tick. It was in Jonesboro, Illinois at the Black Diamond Ranch, and after that... you know, I've been in the finals of 5 world championships, and won 3 of them, won second in one and fourth in the other. But no, it sure has. It's been a blessing, and you know, met a lot of good people. Really nobody that that we absolutely hate, you know. The coon hunters in general are good people. Hunters,
yes, they are.
You know, they'll help you out if you need them, and they're just you know, a good group of people. But we've done this, and when you're out there hunting, you want to be as competitive as you can. You don't want to go out there and just lose, and sometimes you'll have some, you know, altercations or whatever. You're right. Going to have that anytime there's money. Now that they got this angle, and Maynard's got that pro sport going, which is a good organization, and you know, they're giving away a lot of money, and they're doing good in it, which is good. You know, they started something that's good, and hopefully here before long we'll be hunting in some of them. You know, we got a couple this whole litter out of the Snow Bitch and Croson is doing good. Good enough that we can see that they'll be able to compete. You know, mm-hmm. at a young age, we're hunting them right now. And
we're going to turn one of them loose with you tonight, 8 months okay. old.
You know, and on the other hand, about selling them, I've had people call wanting to buy this pup that I've got, and I, you know, I priced it at $10,000. It's 8 months old, and that sounds like a lot of money, and it is a lot of money. But you might go through a dozen more of them before you get one that you even like. So you got to, you know, that has that little extra. This whole litter here worked out real good, and the females that Chuck's been crossing on that dog, what I like is a lot of them's not even related, and there's 2 or 3 good ones in every litter. So mm-hmm. the dog's definitely proven that he's a stud dog, and we're going to try to keep him as healthy as we can so we can get all
I
the
got
pups.
Him tonight too.
Good. Yeah. If people think $10,000 is a lot for a young dog, then they can try and go find consistently a good young dog for $10,000.
Well, the bottom line is, if someone paid you minimum wage for a year's worth of work or whatever, you know, it just costs a lot with the gas, your time, and everything, while somebody else is sitting in there watching TV and staying
eating
warm.
Eating cheese crackers.
Yeah, staying warm by the wood burner, and you're out there doing all the sweat. They're going to pay me for my sweat that I've done.
Especially if it's something you really like and will hunt yourself. Because then they're taking it away from you, and you got to start over.
You bet.
Yep. That's a fact.
So how you said your first time training the dog, you were 11. How did you just hunt it, or how did you train it?
Basically by itself. You know, go out there and just mojo through the woods with it. And I still do that. I don't know if everybody can do that, but we was kind of blessed with living in an area where there was plenty of coons.
Mm-hmm.
And I think a pup is better off if it believes it's the only thing on earth that knows anything about treeing a coon. I really do believe. You talk about breeding for, there's a lot of stuff in dogs that you can breed into them.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of stuff that you can train a little bit into them. And for a young person, he needs to figure out what's trainable and what's not trainable.
Mm-hmm.
What I can't change and what I can change a little bit. You can always enhance something, but to actually put something there that's not already there, it's not, you can't do
it.
Yeah, you can't.
There's no other word to describe it other than train a dog, but you're not really training it. If someone could train a dog to tree coon consistently, then we wouldn't have to worry about breeding. You could just breed anything and it'd all work.
Right. I know for a fact I could reach over here and hit him in the mouth and he's going to fight. There's some people you hit and they're not going to fight. It's natural ability and drive and heart that you don't have a lot. You don't have a lot of input to that. You can always, this boy here, I raised him and he got a lot of heart. He's tough, but I enhanced his abilities that he was born with. I could have made him a spooky, scary type kid if I would have just been mean to him.
Yeah.
And I just enhanced what he already had.
Mm-hmm. That's really good points.
And when you're dealing with dogs, and when you're out there and you spend that much time with a dog, that's a bond that you get, you get with that dog. And most of your guys, I mean, I'm not saying you couldn't go get it, borrow a dog off somebody and win a hunt with it. Most of these guys that's winning has bonds with them dogs, and they know every bark the dog throws, and that's a plus.
And when that bond is broken, sometimes you don't see that dog
do any winning.
Yeah, that's very true.
Yeah.
A lot of people think that that has money thinks they can just buy a dog. Well, that dog, they're going to set, that dog will be good. Hey, that dog won this, that dog won that. Well, that dog's not a machine.
I was just going to say that. They think it's like buying a tractor or a truck. Yes. It's going to do this no matter where it's at.
It's got a heart. It's got a mind.
You have to treat it like such, because there are a lot of, I've noticed it more with squirrel dogs. Some of them get pretty quirky,
to where you bet
they might only hunt really well for one person and they sell it. And then the other person, they don't like something about how they handle the dog or treat them, or,
and that dog just goes totally off the tubes, down the tubes.
The first, the blue tick that Chuck had when we was young, he sold it to a guy, and I think for $1,000 or $1,200, that Billy Hubbard was the guy. And he took the dog home and hunted it the next night or whatever, a couple nights, and called Chuck and said, man, that dog ain't doing very good. And Chuck told him, bring it back. Well, when he come back, he said, well, let's go hunting. So we went hunting, and that dog treed 6 coons, and I climbed up every tree and threw every one of them out to that dog. And we got home, and we were just young. Chuck started walking.
I was going to get him, take him back, get pay him his money back.
Yeah, he said, where are you going with my dog? Chuck said, well, I thought you didn't want him. You know, a dog's got to like you, even as far as a house dog. If a house dog likes you, it'll do more for you, listen to you better. So
that's what my squirrel dog, I say squirrel dog, but I've coon hunted him more than I have squirrel, to be honest. But he's lived in the house since he was a puppy.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't have to even take a leash with him when I go hunting. And if I let him out to go to the bathroom out of the house, if I say go get him, he'll run to the woods and go get treed behind the house. And I can call him, he'll come right back.
Put him in the truck. If you're going to the truck and driving somewhere, he knows what you're doing. He'll go get in the truck.
And he'd probably look good for other people, but there's no doubt he would look best for me, because he has near 8 years of experience trying to please me, living with me.
You bet.
So that makes a huge difference. You know, doing what I do, it's really important that I have high quality equipment that's really dependable and long lasting. Because I am on the road a lot and I hunt in very different conditions and terrains. Could be in the summertime, could be in the wintertime, could be in the mountains, or it could be in flat country. So I'd like to thank my sponsors for all their help making this possible and for all their quality equipment. I'd like to thank Dogtra and the Dogtra tracking systems and the Pathfinder, Big Dog Lights, and my favorite light with them is the Big Dog Blitz, and the Genesis and Genesis Plus are great also, and I've used them for many years. Gun Dog House Doors, because especially in the wintertime, keeping your dogs out of the elements is extremely important. So for long-lasting, high-quality doors for your kennels, check out Gun Dog House Doors. But in the summertime, we have different issues to deal with, like a lot of thick leaves on the trees. So if you want something that'll help you see eyes at night, make sure you check out Bayou Legacy Game Calls with the Tree Shaker Coon Squaller. For high-quality coon hunting clothing, make sure you check out Coon Dog Wear. I'd also like to thank Conkey's Outdoors Hound and Hunting Supply, Ringtails and Tall Tails Hunting Supply and Taxidermy, Bill Schinniger and Saddle Up Cryo. I'd also like to thank Coon Hunter Supply and Razor Hunting Gear. We all love good coon hounds, and if you've been doing this for a while, you'll know how important having a good bloodline is. So when picking a new dog, make sure you keep these stud dogs in mind. World Champion, Platinum Champion, Davis's Rosedale Frogger, Grand Knight Champion, Saddle Up Lazarus, UKC Grand Knight Champion 2, PKC Gold Champion, Backwater Bobo, and PKC Gold Champion, UKC Dual Grand Champion, Buck Creek Croson. And remember, since this is just a podcast, if you want to see the dogs in action, see what they look like, what they sound like, meet their owners, make sure you check out my YouTube channel where you can see all of them dogs in action.
Well, I don't know if there's any other thing. Is there anything you can think of that we never covered? Or?
Well, yeah, I have thought of a couple of things. A couple of dogs that I got off of him that he gets mad quick. If he gets mad at him, they're good as over the hill to the boneyard. And I've saved a couple of their lives
and made money on
and made a bunch of money off of them. But you know, he just likes a certain type of dog, and if they do certain things that he don't like, he's done with them, and I'll give him a little bit more of a chance.
That is something that I think that's just a learning experience you have to go through yourself to where if you notice at a young age there's something you don't like about that dog, to where you might not want it later on. If you know someone might be interested,
match up great with somebody else.
See, try and see if it might be what they're looking for, better style, their personality, like, just so you don't end up with something later on that you're just stuck with and you're not happy with it.
Right.
But that's years of experience. That's something you can't just learn.
And I've got a lot more calm as I got older. You know, when I was, me and him would be out in the woods and I love him and he loves me, but we'd get mad and I might take a .22 and wrap it around the tree if it wasn't working right. I mean, just anything. Yeah. Just anything. But we sure hunted. And I think that if I've learned anything, that you can hunt a dog too hard.
I agree.
I've learned over the years that every night hunting a couple hours is better than hunting every night all night long. Mm-hmm. You know, I thought you didn't quit hunting until the sun come up. And, you know, I learned that it's too hard on your body.
Yeah, we've done that a lot when we was young. And our dad didn't appreciate it. He'd come in from work and we'd hunt all night and sleep all day. And he got fed up with that.
We also had a little training school where we trained dogs for the public years ago. And he'd take three and I'd take three. And I don't know how anybody could take any more than three. And that's when we had anywhere we wanted to hunt, we could hunt. And, you know, nowadays that's not the same.
No.
It's getting harder and harder to find, like, Axel over there, he'll be all right to hunt in places, but he's going to lose a lot of places because we've lost a lot of places. You know, the building and everything else, and the public. I hunt a lot of the public just to keep away from people hollering, and some of it ain't fit for.
Yeah,
you got to drive around and find the places, and I enjoy hunting it because I do not like to hear that screaming and hollering and all that.
Yeah, get out of here and all that stuff.
Yeah, that ain't no good. You know, you can't really enjoy yourself, and it scares a kid anyhow.
Yeah,
you know, somebody come out.
And if people were smart, a good coon hunter would watch over their property. You know, they're not going to tear up nothing.
No.
And if they see something going on that shouldn't be going on, they'll do something about it.
That's the way it used to be everywhere. Like, there's a lot of places where I remember growing up hunting with Dad, and I'll ask him, like, do you know who owns it? Like, no.
We've just always hunted here.
Yeah. That farmer up the road owned it, I think, and he didn't care because we're out killing his coons so they're not eating his crops and we're not bothering nothing.
I can remember me and him when we was teenagers walking down a road, we was hunting, and we passed this, it was in the summertime, we passed this man and woman, and they said, "What are you boys doing? We're out coon hunting. We'll have a good time." And I said, "Who owns it?" He said, "I do." He said, "Just go ahead and hunt wherever you want to, you know, but you don't get that much anymore."
No.
People's changed and it's getting worse and worse and worse. They're crazier than bed bugs.
Yeah, I think television deer hunting has a lot to do with it.
You bet. You bet. Oh, and they want those deer as tame as cows. You know, and shoot a cow?
Yeah.
You walk out there
with
the
a
field.
Name?
Yeah, yeah.
Ear tag and a name.
That don't show you're a real good hunter to me. You know.
No, not I deer hunt. I bow hunt, but I don't own a bunch of property and plant food plots and. Yeah. Run people off and make a big deal about it. I do it just so I have. It's just an awesome
deer hunted. He deer hunts, but now we also know that a coon dog, if it did even run the deer, that deer'd be back there the next day, and that's a fact.
Yeah, that's not even like hunting with Dick Brothers. If anyone's ever been inside of his house and see the deer he has on the wall,
he's killed. Yeah,
bigger than any deer hunter I've ever met.
You bet.
Before.
Right. You bet. And he's a coon hunter too.
Bro. Oh yeah,
good judge. Hey, we should probably, I don't know how to incorporate this in here, but the first great big money hunt that was around, we were fortunate enough to get to hunt in it. He got to hunt in it, and we've all won money in it, and that was the Russ Meyer hunt. Have you ever heard of that?
Mm-hmm.
You know, I really enjoyed that hunt. That is what I think coon hunting. Not necessarily that the entry fee's that big because I can't afford to to go, but it was the epitome of good sportsmanship and a good hunt. Never had any problems out there, none whatsoever. And if I was going to say the most hunt that I've enjoyed to hunt in, was the Russ Meyer. Yeah,
absolutely, because they treated you good, they fed you good, you could do whatever you wanted out there, and they were just good people.
Russ Meyer let you, if you wanted to take his guns out and go kill a turkey, if turkey season was in, you could do it during the day. He was just a gentleman. A gentleman. And how I got to hunt in it for the first time was I sold him a dog, and I hunted that dog in that hunt. I won out of the three nights. I got in the finals twice, and I think I won $9,000. And then I won with a bitch I had. Me and Jim Samples went out there, and I hunted her one night, and I won it. I hunted it off. You always hunted it off. Right. I hunted it off and won it. And you got in one time, didn't you?
Yeah.
But I really enjoyed that hunt, and I really think it'd be to get an audience to not mention that hunt would really be wrong.
Yeah, that was a dandy, you know.
What? So when was your first competition hunts? Do you guys remember that?
Yeah, they were UKC.
Yeah,
hunts. Just local.
Yeah, hunts. UKC hunts.
Me and him both has finished a bunch of dogs, tonight champion, grand night champion.
I couldn't tell you how many.
A bunch of them. And then when the money hunts started coming around.
We loved them a lot better.
Yeah, the money, we started hunting in them. And, you know, well, I've got plenty of trophies. He's got plenty of trophies, and we fill away plenty, just like everybody else has. They're dust collectors, but they're awful pretty.
Yeah.
And, you know, them ones there.
They mean something, man. Right. That's world championship.
You know, I seen where Maynard won that truck with that, what he called the powder female, and he broke down. And it does do that to you. And like I said, it absolutely does it to you, just like with Smith. You know, when I won them world hunts with him, it tears you up to know that you are the reason that dog, you know, finished out to what he.
If I got a litter of pups over at my house, he's over there. He's messing with them, touching them. Same deal with him. And, you know, that they've never seen anybody but us, you know, and it really does touch you. It does.
Because then you know you did right by the dog. You can't do any better for the dog.
If you raise a good child, you know you done a good job. Yeah. You're part of it. I can get a pup, and it's no good.
Right.
I can't make it. I can't. You know. But you know you done your part when you see a dog do a good job.
Like having your son be the winning quarterback of the Super Bowl.
You bet. You bet. That's right.
I seen your podcast with Kurt Ehring.
Yeah.
He said something about me on there. He said, hey, what was that dog Dunlap hunted? That real junky dog. I'm sitting here trying to think of something to say that'll really tee him off. But really, I can't, because when you went to his house, he treated
you like
gold. That's
another thing. Yes.
Yeah.
Like gold.
That dude there, you know, they can say what they want about him, but he's a friend. He's been a friend, and he'll be a friend forever. No. He's a good person.
Yeah, he's a really nice guy.
Yeah.
I think Jeff Stollard is the one that told you to come this way.
He told me. I've had a lot of people request to do that, but he told me. And
there's another good
one. That's another whole group of good ones.
Yeah. Whole group of good ones.
And there's plenty of hunters around, the Burdens. I mean, there's Blackwells. There's plenty of them around Nicky Hale. I got a lot of respect for him. I think he's a real good person.
Ryan Croson, got a lot of respect for him.
Right. Engel's done good. He's done good with the dogs and stuff. And me and him maybe don't see eye to eye on a lot of stuff, but he's done real good. And I'll tell you somebody else. And I got a lot of respect for him, and that's Kevin Cable.
He's done a remarkable job,
and he's a hunter. You know, we spend a lot of time in the woods by ourselves hunting, and a lot of people don't. They got to have a crowd to go with them, and you'd be surprised, you know. And I can understand with older people that has health problems, they shouldn't be out there. But I enjoy being out there. The booger man ain't going to get you. I love being out there training a dog by myself. I just do.
Yeah. I've told people before, especially my wife, my favorite time of year, and most people don't believe me, is like in mid to late December, because there's no undergrowth. It's completely wide open. It's dead silent. Everyone's shut up inside their house. You can just turn a dog loose
and enjoy yourself.
You are just it's like you have the whole world to yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And then that's, I don't know how it is here, but up where I'm at, it's super flat. So you can just hear that dog the blocate echo just for miles. I love hunting that time of year.
Right. Well, Colton, you want to come over here, buddy, and sit
you
down?
You and Axel will come over and sit down.
So you want to introduce yourself?
Yeah, my name's Colton Dunlap, and Chuck Dunlap's my dad, and Don Dunlap's my uncle. I've been coon hunting hard and consistently since I was probably 10 or 11 years old. I've always been around it. You know, growing up with dad, there's always been, you know, big name people coming and staying with my dad and hunting, and so I was always exposed to it. But I didn't really take to it right off the bat when I was so little, and big reason by that being is my dad was a really intense hunter, and it was hard for me to keep up. He wasn't hard on me when we were out there, but it was hard for him to turn that off, being that intense of a hunter, you know. And we would go, and I remember one time in particular, he was training a dog, and it's hilly around here, and I was probably 5 or 6 maybe, and I went with him, and we made a tree. He recut. We went in there. He got treed again. We had a coon there, and I thought, well, you know, we're done. Even at 5 or 6, I think, yeah, you know, that's pretty good. We're done. He cut him again, and he made another tree, and we went in there, and he had another coon. And then I'm thinking, surely he's done now. And then for the fourth time, he cuts him loose again, and I was busted. So at that young and that little, I wanted something, maybe something like steel hunting. I maybe would, you know, be better for me. But I always liked spending time with my dad ever since I was young. He was my best friend, and no matter what we was doing, it didn't matter if we was hunting or whatever, he was my best friend. I mean, and so I wanted something to do with him. And I told dad, I said, Dad, you know, this coon hunting, man, this might not be for me. And he said, well, that doesn't matter. We'll do whatever you want to do. And even with being a hard hunter, he found time to take me deer hunting and squirrel hunting and teaching me how to, you know, get through the woods and not lay around the house, you know, and be busy. And even when I wasn't coon hunting, he showed me how to take care of a dog, which I think is a great thing for a young man to do. Teaches you early in life a lot of responsibility. And he was just always really good to me. Well, how I come about coon hunting hard, like I said, big name people was always coming to the house, and they were always staying. And the big reason why that, because when they came, it wasn't an ice cream social, it was coon hunting. They could bring their dogs that they were wanting to compete, and they could come with him, and he would hunt them as long as they wanted, all night, as many as nights as they wanted to hunt. And so at this particular time, Doug Jackson was there. And at a young age, Doug was very good to me. When he would come, he'd always bring me candy and was just really, really good to me. I considered him family, you know. And me and him was kind of palling around that day, and I was palling around with him and Dad, and I got to thinking, I was like, Dad, I think I'm going to go with you tonight, which was kind of rare at that time. And my dad said, well, buddy, Doug's here to hunt, so we're going to hunt. And, you know, I think we was going up to Jim Samples that night. So we're going away from the house. It's not like we can drop you off. And I said, well, yeah, I want to go. Well, that night I toted the gun around for everybody. I led dogs and handled dogs for people. And I just had a big time. And I really put it, because I really wanted to impress Doug and make him, you know, at a young age, you wanted to make a good impression on him. And my dad at the end of the night said, you know, son, you was a big help out here. Well, my head just swelled up huge, you know, hearing that come from my dad, somebody I looked up to as a hunter. And not to sound corny, but I hunted with him every night since. And what amazed me with my dad was knowing how much that he loved the sport and how much time he put in the sport, how quick he took a back seat for me. It was almost instantly. From the moment that I said I wanted to start hunting, he was in his prime. He was in good shape. There was no health problems. You know, a lot of people think that I hunt his dogs for him because he can't get around. He's hunting on a bone-on-bone knee right now, and he still goes every night. He could tack as much as you could give him. He wanted to see me do good, and that's a rare thing, and it's a shame that not every young man gets that. But I had that with him. So he kind of set me down. Yeah, I started going hunting. He seen that I had a pretty good dog ear on me, and which is an important thing to have. You know, not everybody, I don't think, has a good dog ear. Not everybody can step out with a dog and understand what a dog's doing, you know. And at a young age, I had a pretty good dog ear on me, and we started out, of course, pleasure hunting. And he kind of seen that I may have the tools to make a pretty good competition hunter. And this was pretty soon into hunting with him consistently. And he said to me, he said, look, if you want to do this, I will show you how to do this. But this is going to be intense. You know, it's going to be like boot camp, you know. Not meaning that he was going to be mean to me, but this was not going to school dances and not going to football games. This was hunting every single night, much like a program he puts a pup through. It's every night in the woods, you know. And I said, yeah, I want to do it, man. I want to do it. And it was on, man. We sat down. I remember sitting down hours with the PKC Blue Book, which is what we exclusively hunted. And he didn't throw me right into going to cast. You know, he didn't, you know, I know some people have done that, but he didn't.
I let you watch me.
Yeah, he let me watch him. He didn't want me to embarrass myself, is what it was, you know. And so he would sit down and we would go through the rules, and that's dry material. And, you know, you're trying to keep a grasp on it. You're young, you know, but you want to take a grasp on it. And then at the end, he would give me scenarios. Dog A did this, dog B did this, dog C did this. And I would answer, and if I got it right, it was a good job. If it wasn't, we'd go over the rule again until I learned it, you know. So that's what kind of got me in. And then it still wasn't time to hunt in a competition hunt. We would get together, get together with some local hunters. Brian Reed and Travis Holberg were really good to me when I was young. They were local guys that lived around here. And we would do mock casts. And my dad would judge, and there was no favoritism. I remember one time I just got out of my mouth thinking about treeing my dog, and he minused me. He made me. He said, no, you, that dog isn't treed. You're going to take your minus. And, of course, it's a mock cast, but to a young kid like me, it meant a lot, you know. And I was heartbroken about that and whatever, but it was, you know, and you know, a very good teaching moment doing those mock casts. And I think that's – and I want to say this, not knocking anybody down, because I know not everybody has been as blessed as I had. I think sometimes people make that leap just a little too fast before diving into that rule book and, you know, learning your dog. I think that's a mistake that happens. You know, everybody sees, especially with social media now, they see somebody winning and they want the prize. You know, they want the prize, but they don't want to put the work in, and they don't want to. And I was blessed. You know, I was definitely blessed with him, because he taught me at a young age, you got to apply yourself if you're going to do good. Right. So we did those mock casts. I got pretty comfortable, and I started into the competitions. And at the time, I believe, I forget the first dog I started hunting. I think it was Ann. That's the dog that he won the Russ Meyer hunt with that he just talked about. And she was a brutal dog for a youth hunter to hunt, man. She was tough. She was a low-end strike dog. She had a good enough mouth, but she was a, you know, she would out-hunt her mouth sometimes. You know what I mean? And she was, and at that time you couldn't use Garmin's. Not that you can tree your dog off a Garmin, but it's nice to know where a tight mouth dog's going. You know what I mean? So I would hunt her, and I remember my first big win with her. We get up to the Onstead Pro Hunt, and at this time I had a few open events under my belt, and I'm not sure if I'd done any good yet or not. Very few casts under my belt.
You had done some good.
I had done some good, maybe. But we get there, and Dad says, well, what about you hunting her tonight? And I was like, well, I don't know. I'm looking around here, and I see guys that I've seen in the magazines, you know. And I'm like, I don't know about this, man. You know, and I know how tough she is. And he's like, just do it. First round, go out there, and I get beat. But I do a good job handling the dog. He even told me that. I was a little bit discouraged. I was like, maybe you ought to hunt her late. And he's like, no, you started this. You got this, man. The late round, I remember it specifically, man. This is a cast that sticks with me forever, like your first wins normally do. I drew Sluggo Peyton, who was doing a lot of winning at the time, Scott Engel with Mojo Mason, and Josh Forsey, who hunted the Mojo dogs, and he was a big-time winning handler. So I got a stack friggin' cast, man. And here I am. I'm, like, standing at, like, 5 foot tall and little chubby kid, and I'm out here with this the no-name dog, you know, this Buck Creek dog, and they got these dogs that's getting their pictures in the magazines and everything, and I'm, well, here we go. And I remember winning that cast, and we walked around in the swamps all night, and I was, you know, I was pretty chapped the next, I was chapped the next day, and what won me the cast, she treed a coon right out of the truck, and then she did like she often did. She split off and got way in there, and I walked around, and we walked us a few circle trees and stuff like that, and I got her treed in at about a mile, and she was treating somebody's yard on a pine tree right by a swimming pool, and I found that coon, and man, I was ecstatic. Made the top 16. I didn't go any further, but man, that was a big win for me, man. That was a win that, like I said, will stick with me forever. And then after that, you know, he's always trained dogs. He's the best with a pup, in my opinion. And I might be a little biased, but whatever. He's the best with the pup I've ever seen, and I've seen a lot with pups. And so I started training dogs with him, and I think the first dog we trained together was probably Stickit. And I did a lot of winning with her. I won the youth state championship and PKC once. I won the PKC the Ohio State championship with her twice, and did a lot of winning. I didn't really get to take her and compete her in a lot of big hunts because we were promoting ourselves, and I did a lot of winning with her. And she's, like I said, the first dog that we trained. In between that time, when I won the youth world hunt, I won it with a Buck Creek dog. We didn't train her, Stella. I won it in 2012. And then in my article that I did for my interview, I mentioned how much I liked the Russ Meyer hunt. And Russ Meyer invited me out there to hunt. And
he paid the entry for me.
He cut a deal with me, of course, you know, but he, and I took another female that was out of the Buck Creek and female that I won my first cast with. I took her out there and I got in one night, and that was a great time, man. That I got treated so well out there, and I, you know, got to be in the finals with some really big name guys, and I think I took third that year, but still it was exhilarating to win like that. And you know, they touched on it. It's different, and I'll probably be repeating what they said, but it's different when you watch a pup come into the world and they got their eyes closed and they're crawling around on a box floor and they don't know sense of nothing, and then you see them open their eyes and they start eating, and then they get out there and you tease them with a coon tail and you see that the instinct's in them that they want a tree, and you take them through all those steps, you put all that time into them, and then when you're standing there and you're holding that dog on that bench and you get your picture taken, and you just, all those memories come through your head. And you're like, how did we even get here? And it's pride. You're proud of the dog. Yeah. You know what I mean. But
and what he said about the Myers hunt, that was a great hunt. And really, they had no trouble at all. There was only one guy that I know of that had to go to the principal's office, and he knows who he is. We won't mention their names.
Yeah, he's just trying to stir trouble now. It's. Training dogs with my dad has created more memories for me that I'll carry to the grave than anything else. Coon hunting for me means so much to me because it's developed a bond with my dad that I feel is so rare in the world. He's not my dad, just my dad. He's my best friend, man. Mm-hmm. And being out there, even on the bad nights, and him talking me off the ledge whenever, you know, when you're young, you don't understand everything, and you're trying to train this dog, and you've showed it this time and time again, and it messes up again, and you get mad, and he would be right there, man, and he always knew what to say, and he's always known what to say with anything in life that I've, you know, went about doing. He's always been there and showed me, and that's what all the wins, all the money, all the good dogs don't match up to the relationship that coon hunting has built with that man over there. He's my best friend. I mean, if you could be like, we have a brotherly connection and a father and son connection. We're that tight. You know what I mean?
That's interesting too, because if you are younger and your dad has really good dogs, if that's your first experience as a good dog, and then you go to train one on your own, your expectations are way higher than what it should be for a young pup.
Absolutely.
So that's good that you had a mentor that would kind of walk you through that process to where you're not just beating your head against the wall thinking,
absolutely,
this 6-month-old pup should be in there 800 yard street with a coon right now.
Right.
Because
right. That's just, absolutely. That's exactly right, man. That is exactly right. And I'll tell you, I always hunted with a good dog, and I'm not bragging. He always kept a good dog, and there's a rarity to good dog work. Not every dog's good, obviously. Mm-hmm. You know, not every dog is good, and you think that good dogs are, and good dog work is more abundant than what it is. And then you think that you can go out and get any dog, and that's where he touched on bloodline, you know. Like you, and you said it too. You said it's not really training a dog; you're just enhancing instinct, mm-hmm. basically. And that's why good bloodline's so important. And I, as a young buck, you get in that age around 16 or 17, you think you're going to reinvent the wheel and show pops up. And I fell on my butt a few times trying to do that, and trying to, you know, get away from his stuff and trying to show. I'll show him. I'll start my own stuff, you know, and it. I was never really defiant, but I wanted to like impress him and show him, you know, show him up, you know. But it's been a great ride, coon hunting. And now we got Axel here. He goes hunting with me, and he's actually killed his first coon with me. He's a great hunting partner, man. And this kid here, his grandpa's done a great job with him. He's as sharp as a tack. He knows what a dog's doing. He knows how to get through the woods, and he's not one you got to carry around, you got to lead around by the ear whenever you're out there. He's right there with you.
He's got a pretty good squirrel dog. Tell him his name.
My name is Axel Dunlap, and like he was saying about how when he was younger and Hun was a good dog, he was expecting a lot more. Well, like when Chuck sold Buck Creek Axe, I didn't know what to expect out of Buck Creek Scream. I'm like, this is going to be the best dog ever. As soon as I hunted with it, and it kind of just fell down from there because I had super high expectations for that dog.
Yeah.
You like the Axe female.
Yeah, he was ready. He was ready to boot Scream to the curb right off the bat. He didn't even give her a chance, man. But yeah, he's been around some good dogs for his young age, and it's nice seeing that because I look at him and I see myself. Mm-hmm. I see myself, and you don't when you're little like that, you don't think you're little and stuff like that.
My brother shares him with me, and I really appreciate that.
Yeah, yeah. And he, I see myself in him, and I can only imagine the stuff he's going to do. But even if it's not in coon hunting with the outdoors, you know, right. And it's awesome. He's a good fisherman for sure, man. He is.
Well, let's go hunting.
All right, let's go hunting, Clayton. Let's go
hunting. Sounds good.
I've rambled on enough.
Well, that was a great interview, and I had a great time hunting with them that night. They're really great people. And if you're listening to this and you haven't seen the video yet, make sure you go on over to my YouTube channel. Just type in Clayton Stark or Stark Outdoors. It'll bring it up. You actually get to see the guys and meet them and see their dogs in action. And I hope you guys are enjoying these podcasts. I'm going to start doing more of them more frequently on these trips. And I have a few other things with this podcast plan that I think you'll really all enjoy. And thank you all for your support, and I'll talk to you next time.
You end up treeing 7/10 of a mile. Had my light on coming in, and he had another coon, so turned him loose 3 times, he had 3 coons.
Oh,